Welcome to Worship at Christ Church. We are living into our mission of building inclusive community, sharing Christ's transforming love. We celebrate that the Spirit of God can still bring us together spiritually as a church family. We pray that you feel the presence of God in real ways all throughout this service today.
Are you new to Christ Church? Get better connected to this community of faith by texting hello to the number you see on the screen to receive a welcome message from our pastor and connection team.
If you haven't already done so, please go to our website at christumc.net. Once you're there, you can submit your prayer requests, learn about our secure giving opportunities, or register your attendance if you're worshiping online.
Do you have a child or youth that's not connected to the church yet? Visit the Christ Kids and Youth pages on our website to learn more about these ministries and how they are still staying active and engaging.
This year has been a challenge to so many in our community. Health concerns related to COVID-19, unemployment or reduced work hours, challenges of meeting the educational needs of our children, and so much more. This year's Christmas offering will go to support agencies that have met the challenges that so many have faced due to the pandemic. Human Services Center Corporation and South Hills Interfaith Movement have been proactive in providing financial assistance, emotional support, and food to those who have been struggling. Hear now a story of how one family has benefited from the services of Supports for Success at Human Services Center Corporation.
Hi, my name is Chicole Winman, and I'm a client of Supports for Success. They have helped me tremendously through getting through some very tough times due to COVID. I've gotten assistance with counseling. I've got assistance with utilities. I've got assistance with rent. I've got assistance with clothing. I've even got assistance to help me whenever I got into a car accident. And everything that they do and have done for me is very much, very much appreciated. I've also gotten just support from my counselor when needed. I feel like I can call her and talk to her about certain things that, you know, she's able to relate to me and help me and talk me through things. This COVID season has been really tough on my family, being a single mother of three children. Two of my children have disabilities, and I'm a full-time college student. I work full-time, and just dealing with all of that on top of COVID was very, very eye-opening. But Supports for Success have been there. Their webinars are awesome. The case managers are awesome, and it's a wonderful program. Thank you.
Your Christmas offering will help these organizations continue to meet the needs of the growing number of individuals who seek help in this new year. You can give online at christumc.net/giving, highlighting the Christmas offering in the drop-down box, using your Christmas offering envelope, or by sending in a check to Christ Church, noting Christmas offering in the memo. Thank you for your generosity, and may your Christmas observances be blessed.
We want to thank you for worshiping with us today. Wherever we are physically, we celebrate that we are together as Christ Church.
Your strength and come to live. called me to your kingdom, for your lips could speak, and even as a baby you were reaching out for me.
Thank you for joining us in worship today. We're so grateful for all the ways God is leading us as Christ Church to connect, grow, and give. Thank you to each and every one of you who are faithfully mailing your tithes and offerings into the church or who continue to give through our secure online giving platform. You are making a difference. For those of you who want to start giving, you can access online giving by visiting our church website at christumc.net. Your faithful support of Christ Church is meeting the needs and changing the lives of individuals and families throughout our church, our community, and our city. It is exciting to see Christ Church discover new and unique ways to live into our mission of building inclusive community, sharing Christ-transforming love. I just wanted to say thank you and give everyone a quick update on Angel Tree 2020. We have received around 500 gifts valued at over $9,000. Again, thank you for your support of this wonderful ministry. And remember, everything we have is a gift from God. May God continue to bless and multiply all the gifts for the work of spreading that transforming love around the world.
The lighting of our Advent wreath is a wonderful tradition that we share every year during worship each week of Advent. This year, as with so many of our other familiar practices and traditions, lighting the Advent candles in worship will look a little different. However, just like so many of the other shifts that have been made in the ministry of Christ Church, we know God is still at work and moving in new ways. In just a few moments, we're going to be blessed by the Wary family leading us in our Advent candle lighting. Since we are not all able to join together in experiencing the warmth and light of this candle of love in person, we would like to encourage you to join together in this special tradition in your own home each week of Advent by lighting a candle together with us during worship. You can light your own family's Advent wreath. You can light a simple single candle or a tea light. Whatever you have will work perfectly. This is an opportunity for us to join together in this act of worship, even while we are all worshiping apart. Throughout the history of the church, we have lit candles in our worship as a symbol of the presence of the Holy Spirit, just like in the flames of Pentecost. As we live into this new season in the life of our church, we would like to invite you to join together with us in this new and special way of sharing in the lighting of our Advent candles.
The third candle of Advent represents joy. Joy is a word we see and hear everywhere at Christmas. Joy to the world is the message of this season. We can see joy all around us, through the excitement of children, the bright lights that decorate the season, and the holiday music. But how often do we let our preparations or our memories push joy to the side? Joy is like an underground spring that wells up within us, but joy is also a choice, an attitude, like a muscle. It needs to be exercised. So today, we open ourselves to joy, trusting that God has already planted it in us. All we need to do is give it care and offer it to share. God shines the light of joy through Jesus into our world.
Please join me in prayer. Dear God, as we light these candles, we thank you for providing us hope, love, and joy in this world through your Son, Jesus. Help us to joyfully share the good news of Jesus' birth and the message of his life in our world. Through faith in him, give us joy that lasts long beyond this Christmas season and that helps us to face the adversities of life. Make room for joy in our lives, our hearts, and our world. Amen.
Amen.
We invite you to submit your prayer requests either online at christumc.net or call into the office. We have an intercessory prayer team that will pray for you and keep all of your concerns in mind. Please join me as we pray. Heavenly God, we face so many challenges during this Advent season and the halfway point to Christmas. We remember how Mary and Joseph struggled traveling just before the birth of Jesus to register as Roman citizens in their town of Bethlehem. Some of us can relate to Jesus' parents because they had troubles just like us. Still, God, we praise your holy name in this joyful and exciting season because the story of Mary, Joseph, and of course, baby Jesus didn't end there. Even in our struggles, may we find joy as we continue to anticipate the birth of Jesus Christ, your Son. Many in the congregation are feeling joy, and they're also suffering. For the many facing daunting challenges, we bring our concerns to the altar. Those mourning for loved ones who have passed away, many directly impacted by COVID-19, our siblings who are unemployed or underemployed, the hardworking staff at Christ Church who continue to serve even with the challenges of the pandemic, frontline workers, including those in retail and hospitals, difficult relationships, poor health, and serious illness. And as we remember all of these concerns, let us now turn to Christ and share in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Be the angels sing, there's hope for everyone. To announce our King, there's hope for everyone. What good news they bring, there's hope for everyone. Angels sing, there's hope for everyone. They came from afar, everyone. Wise men saw the star, there's hope for everyone. Shepherds heard the choir, there's hope for everyone. From afar, there's hope for everyone. We are waiting on the promise for the one who lights the dark. For everyone on the manger floor, there's There's hope for everyone. What are you waiting for? There's hope for everyone. Come adore this home for everyone. We are waiting on a promise. For the one who lights the darkness. Bending low to be among us. Bring your glory in the highest. Jesus, come and roll the clouds. There's hope for everyone. Hear the trumpet sound. There's hope for everyone.
Good morning. So glad you could join us for worship this morning. I can't believe we're already at the third Sunday of Advent. Time seems to be flying by. I sure am glad that we've taken the time to prepare for the coming of the true light this Advent season, like we talked about 2 weeks ago. I'm also glad for the wonderful reminder from Pastor Diane last week about the importance of love in our life as we prepare for the coming of Jesus. As we enter week 3 of Advent, I want to take some time to talk about expectations. More specifically, how God goes beyond our expectations. Let's take a look at our scripture this morning from Luke chapter 2, verses 1 to 20. I'm sure this is a pretty familiar passage to all of you during this Advent season. Hear these words from the book of Luke. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in clothes and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths, lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby, who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds had said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Now, let me ask you a question. Have you ever had a set of expectations in your mind about something that was going to happen, only to be let down because the results fell way short of your expectations? I mean, we can prepare and plan for an event until we're blue in the face, but it never seems to turn out the way we expected. Let me give you some examples from good old Pinterest. Now, I'm sure many of you watching today use Pinterest on a regular basis. If you don't, allow me to explain what Pinterest is. It's a social networking tool for showing off creative craft ideas, DIY projects, different recipes, and other creative things that you can do. Hundreds of thousands of people try to replicate what they have seen on Pinterest in their own homes. However, many times the results of our trying fall well short of the expectations that we see on the Pinterest boards. So much so, there's this new trend called Nailed It, where you can see the Pinterest expectations versus the failed attempts. Let's take a look at some of these Pinterest fails. Thankfully, these folks were willing to laugh at themselves and submit some of these pictures. Take a look. Clearly, these attempts fell way short of their expectations. Now, on a more serious note, I'm sure that what we have experienced this year has fallen short of the expectations we had for this year. I doubt anyone envisioned a global pandemic that we would be dealing with. I know as a church, we had some really great expectations of what we were going to do for Easter and for Christmas Eve this year, that due to the pandemic, we're not able to do. I'm sure if you're like me, you had expectations of what would happen during the holiday season that you haven't been able to do. It seems like every direction we turn, we're not able to meet the expectations we have. It feels like one of those holiday movies where everything goes wrong. You know, like National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation. That movie describes a holiday season that starts off like it will be perfect, but it ends up a troubled disaster. From burnt turkeys to obnoxious family members that start fires, the movie helps shatter the expectation of perfection that we have come to expect during the holiday season. However, there is a moral to the disasters in that movie. The main characters come to realize that what they need to value is what's most important, and not their less important expectations. You see, God has an amazing way of going beyond our expectations. God wants us to prepare and anticipate the movement of God in our lives. However, we need to realize that God will do things God's way. And we see this play out from the very beginning, when Jesus first came to earth as a baby. Did you know that the story of Jesus is a story of God shattering human expectations on who the Messiah is? The birth of Jesus was expected and prepared for, but it was also unexpected in the way that it occurred. You see, the Savior of the world was born to a young couple fleeing persecution, born in a manger with shepherds, wise men, and the angels, which is a great story that we tell every year. The problem was the expectation for the Savior of the world, who was also known as the King of Israel, were totally different than what we read. The expectation of the coming Messiah was that he would be a warrior king born to a noble family. But Jesus was born to a blue-collar carpenter's family. Mary was not a queen. Joseph was not a ruling king. The expectation of the coming Messiah was that he would be born in a palace surrounded by servants and silk sheets. Jesus wasn't born in a palace surrounded by servants and silk sheets. Jesus was born in straw, surrounded by shepherds. Now let me pause here for a second and talk about those shepherds. You see, the shepherds are a perfect example of how God goes beyond our expectations. Who does God announce the birth of Jesus to? Who does God invite to come and see the new baby? The answer? A ragtag collection of sheep herders. Now, there's only one announcement of Christ's birth recorded in Scripture. Only one invitation from God to anyone to come visit Mary and Joseph and the infant Jesus. And that one invitation goes to a bunch of uneducated, smelly, low-class, social and religious outcasts. A bunch of shepherds. Now let me tell you a little bit about shepherds. They were the last people that you would expect God to take notice of. First of all, they were religious outcasts. According to Jewish religious law, shepherds were unclean. Their line of work prevented them from participating in the feast and holy days that made up the Jewish religious calendar. Why? Well, somebody had to watch the sheep. When everyone else was making the trip to Jerusalem to make sacrifices at the temple or to participate in one of the annual feasts, the shepherds were out in the fields watching over the sheep. A modern day example might be a trucker or a shift worker whose job keeps them from regularly attending church. Wasn't really their fault, but they were looked down on from a religious point of view. Whatever they believed in their hearts, they weren't able to participate fully in the religious life of the community. Not only that, but shepherds were borderline social outcasts. I mean, they were constantly on the move to find new pastures for their flocks. They were looked on with suspicion. They were often accused of being thieves. If something came up missing, well, it must have been one of those shepherds. They were not even permitted to give testimony in a legal proceeding because their word wasn't considered to be trustworthy. And on top of all of that, they really didn't have much contact with other people. Most of the time, they were living out in the fields, as we read about in verse 8. This was not a 40-hour-a-week job. They didn't come home at night. They were with the sheep 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. During the day, they led the sheep to grass and water so they could eat. They watched while the sheep grazed. They kept an eye out for predators like wolves. And at night, they actually slept in the sheep pen with the sheep to guard against theft and other animal attack. Good shepherds could identify each one of their sheep by sight. They knew their sheep, and their sheep knew them. Listen to these words from John about a shepherd. John says, "The man who enters the gate is the shepherd of his sheep. The watchman opens the gate for him, and the sheep listens to his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes on ahead of them, and his sheep follow him because they know his voice." You see, being a shepherd was lonely, wearisome, usually pretty boring and tedious, and sometimes even extremely dangerous. It gave them a lot of contact with sheep, but very little exposure to people. It's no wonder that David in the Old Testament, the shepherd who became king of Israel, was such an accomplished musician. Many shepherds learned to play the flute or harp or some other instrument because they had hours and hours with nothing to do but watch sheep eat grass. Doesn't that make you feel better about your job? Or maybe it sounds appealing to you. I don't know. Anyway, shepherds, they didn't have much social contact. Put it this way. You probably wouldn't want your daughter to marry one. Now, step back for a moment. Imagine you're God, and you want to announce the most amazing, incredible, joyous news ever given, an event which will literally change the course of history, the birth of your only son, Jesus the Christ, the birth of the one who will be the savior of the entire world, the one for whom the nation of Israel had been waiting and hoping and praying for thousands of years. Finally, he has come. Who do you announce it to? Who do you tell? Who do you invite to come and see? The expectation of who you would tell is not the shepherds, but God goes beyond our expectations. Let's modernize this just a little bit. When a child is born to a member of the British royalty, for instance, when Prince William and Catherine had Prince George, they didn't send a messenger down to the docks to break the news first to the dock workers. They didn't issue personal invitations to the cab drivers of London to come and visit them and their new infant at Windsor Castle. I'm guessing that if any announcements or invitations were sent out, they were printed on gold leaf and hand-delivered to political leaders and foreign heads of state. The point is that the expectation for an event like the birth of Christ would be announced to the most important people in the nation, political leaders, kings, governors, magistrates, even Caesar might be invited to come and pay homage to the future ruler. Religious leaders, priests, rabbis, synagogue officials, the head of the Jewish ruling council, the Sanhedrin, they would all be invited to worship their Messiah. Military leaders, wealthy merchants, men and women of distinction, the news media. But none of them got the word. None of them were invited. Now, some foreign kings figured it out by following the Star of Bethlehem, and they informed King Herod, but they didn't get an angelic messenger or an angel choir or an invitation. Only these few poor shepherds, these social and religious outcasts, received the announcement. I mean, can you imagine the conductor of the angel choir announcing this to the shepherds? It's as if the Mormon Tabernacle Choir were to rehearse all year to perform Handel's Messiah, but then gave the concert for the eight people left in the building that were on the building's maintenance crew. So why? Why did God do this? Why did he send angels to announce the birth of Christ to these shepherds, to invite them and only them to come and see the child? I mean, were the shepherds especially pious, unusually holy? I mean, in spite of the fact that they couldn't participate in organized religion, were they just outstanding in their field? Get it? It's doubtful, although the passage does say that when they got the news, they believed what the angels said and they did what the angels told them to do. But there's nothing in the text to indicate that they were more religious than anyone else. Were they perhaps expecting this? Were they looking for God to visit them? Could they have anticipated this in any way? No. In fact, if I'm a shepherd, I'm probably convinced God has no idea who I even am. I don't sacrifice at the temple. I don't show up for the feast. I don't go to the synagogue. And my deepest theological discussions are with a bunch of dumb sheep. If God does know who I am, God probably can't think that much of me. So why did God send the angels first to the shepherds? Well, several possible answers have been proposed, such as the fact that Jesus himself is later called the Good Shepherd, caring for us as his flock. But I prefer a simpler explanation. God went beyond our expectations. God wanted to show us that the love that comes from God does not discriminate on the basis of class, color, wealth, or social standing. God does not respect kings and princes more than hourly laborers. God does not value priests and pastors above the people in the pews or online. God does not show favoritism. God does not give preferential treatment to one group of people over another. God's love is available to all on the same basis, faith in Jesus Christ and faith alone. In fact, many passages of Scripture indicate that God loves to lift up the lowly and the humble, while at the same time bringing down the proud and the self-satisfied. For example, in 2 Samuel 22, it says, "You save the humble, but your eyes are on the haughty to bring them low." Or in Psalm 149:4, "For the Lord takes delight in his people. The Lord crowns the humble with salvation." Elsewhere in Scripture, it says, "This is what the Lord says. These are the ones I esteem, they who are humble and contrite in spirit and trembles at my word." Or in Matthew 23, "For whoever exalts themselves will be humbled, and whoever humbles themselves will be exalted." You see, God opposes the proud but gives grace to the humble. 1 Peter tells us to humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, and he will lift you up in due time. So in other words, God was demonstrating, by the choice of these humble shepherds to be the first to receive the news of Christ's birth, that Jesus was not going to be the Savior of only the political and social and religious elite. Jesus was not going to be the Savior only of kings and governors or popes and priests. Jesus is the Savior of all equally. He doesn't give preference to any group or any class, nor does he discriminate on the basis of intelligence or education or wealth or profession or political power or social standing or any of the other qualities that human beings judge by. God's love is offered indiscriminately to anyone who will repent and believe, anyone who will trust in Jesus as Savior. God goes beyond any expectations that we have. You know, it's interesting to me that according to several surveys, most people identify the most with the shepherds from the Christmas story. I think if we're honest, it's because we often feel like the shepherds in the sense that we don't deserve God's gift of God's good grace. Our expectation of ourselves is we aren't good enough. But remember, God goes beyond our expectations. So if you identify with the shepherds, you should be encouraged. Perhaps you see yourself as kind of on the outside looking in. I imagine that many of the nights as the shepherds sat outside in those cold and lonely fields with nothing but dumb animals to keep them company, that they looked over at the village and they saw the lights coming from people's homes and heard the faint sounds of families and people laughing and wished that they could be part of that. Maybe you felt that way also. Maybe you don't feel especially wealthy or powerful or influential. Maybe you're not likely to ever see your name in the paper for some great accomplishment. Or you're on the fringes socially. Maybe when you compare your level of religious observance to others, the comparison maybe isn't favorable. You know, spotty church attendance, too little Bible reading, infrequent prayer. And you think that if God is even aware you exist, which in your mind you probably don't think is the case at all, that God probably doesn't have a very favorable opinion of you. And you know what? A lot of people deep down secretly feel like that. Even people who you would think of having it all together. They feel that way if they're honest. On the surface, everything is going great, but on the inside, they feel like they just don't fit in. We all can feel like God doesn't really care, couldn't care about someone like us. Well, if any of those descriptions strikes a chord with you, then I have got good news, great news, actually the best news possible. God goes beyond our expectations. God loves us, just like God loved those shepherds. And we are special to God, just like those shepherds were special. So special that God gave them the incredible privilege of being the first to hear of Christ's birth, being the first people other than Mary and Joseph to lay eyes on the Son of God, being the first to tell others about Jesus. God didn't give those privileges to the Roman leaders or to the Jewish high priests. He gave it to the shepherds, not in spite of who they were, but because of who they were. Humble, ordinary people with no high opinions of themselves, simply people who were willing to believe what God told them and then to do what God commanded them. When they heard the news, they didn't seek out religious professionals for a second opinion. They simply accepted what the angels told them. When they were invited to visit Bethlehem to see the newborn Messiah, they didn't worry about who was going to watch their sheep. They didn't get bogged down in debates about how they were going to find one small baby in a town like Bethlehem. They simply obeyed and went. Advent is about realizing that God goes beyond our expectations. God has good gifts in store for all of us, but we have to be ready to receive them. That receiving might not always look like what we think it should look like. Just as Jesus went beyond the limited expectations that the people had for the coming Messiah way back then, God can go beyond our own expectations now. Ephesians 3:20 says God is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine. Now we can begin to learn more about God and align our expectations with God's through reading the Bible and prayer. Reading the Bible and praying is our way of communicating with God. As we read and pray, our expectations change, and we realize that God goes way beyond the expectations that we have. Remember earlier in the message, I mentioned that the reality of 2020 fell short of the expectations that any of us had due to the pandemic, personally or as a church. Well, truth be told, if I stop and think about it, God has actually gone way beyond my expectations. Sure, 2020 has been full of things that on the surface look like they fell short of my expectations. However, as I look back over the last 9 months, God has done things that I could have never imagined. For example, the holiday gatherings that I was so upset about missing has allowed me the opportunity to spend more time with my wife and my girls and appreciate my immediate family. I miss everyone, sure, but I'm blessed for this newfound appreciation of my immediate family. God went beyond my expectations. I've seen our church be open to so many new ways to do ministry, such as online worship. We've tried so many new things, and all of you have jumped on board and made the best of what looked like an awful situation. In fact, we've been able to reach people that we haven't been able to reach for years. We've been able to streamline what we do and focus on worship and growing as disciples. Again, God is going beyond our expectations. Remember when I mentioned Easter and Christmas Eve and not living up to what we thought they would? Well, on Palm Sunday, our contemporary service was picked up by the Worldwide United Methodist Church Facebook feed, and we reached around 30,000 people from around the world. Talk about God going beyond our expectations. During this Advent season, I know it can be easy to become frustrated and think our expectations haven't been met. But remember, God is in the business of going beyond our expectations. My prayer for all of us is that we are ready to receive the good gifts that God has in store for us this Advent season, that will go way beyond our expectations, starting with the most important gift, a relationship with Jesus. Let's pray. Lord, we are just grateful. We are grateful that you go beyond any expectations that we could ever have. Lord, it can feel overwhelming sometimes. It can feel like we're being let down sometimes. But help us to put our focus on you. Help us to put our focus on your Son, Jesus. When we receive that gift, everything changes. And you go beyond any expectations that we could ever have. But it all starts with that relationship. You loved us enough to send your Son. May we receive that gift. And as we do, we'll realize that our lives will never be the same. And that you will do immeasurably more than whatever we could ask or imagine. Help us to spend time studying your word. Help us to spend time praying and asking for your guidance. And help us to change our expectations, knowing that your expectations are far greater than any we could have for ourselves. Thank you for the precious gift of your Son, and may we receive that gift on this Advent morning. And everyone said together, Amen.
Everlasting Lord,
As we look to finish our year in a strong financial position, I again want to thank all of you who have taken the time to mail your offering to the church and have started or continue to give with our secure online giving. Your generosity allows Christ Church to continue to provide ministry in new, unique, and exciting ways every day. Thank you again for helping us finish our year financially strong so our ministries can continue without interruption. If you haven't already, please be sure to go to christumc.net and sign in using our attendance button. You can also share a prayer concern or give using those buttons on the homepage. And don't forget, you can always go to the church website to find out more information about everything going on in the life of Christ Church. Thank you for all the ways that you have continued to live out your faith as we continue building inclusive community, sharing Christ's transforming love.
Let us join now in an affirmation of faith. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is one true church, apostolic and universal, whose holy faith let us now declare. We believe in God the Father, infinite in wisdom, power, and love, whose mercy is over all his works, and whose will is ever directed to his children's good. We believe in Jesus Christ, Son of God and Son of Man, the gift of the Father's unfailing grace, the ground of our hope, and the promise of our deliverance from sin and death. We believe in the Holy Spirit as the divine presence in our lives, whereby we are kept in perpetual remembrance of the truth of Christ and find strength and help in time of need. We believe that this faith should manifest itself in the service of love, as set forth in the example of our blessed Lord. To that end, that the kingdom of God may come upon the earth. Amen.
Thank you for joining us for worship this morning. Remember, no matter how we feel, no matter what it looks like, even if we feel that our expectations haven't been met, God is in the business of going beyond our expectations. Receive the gift that He has sent of His Son. And when you do, be ready. Be ready for what God has in store for you. Go in God's peace. God bless.
Come adore, oh Ben. King.